You're listening to a bonus episode of The Voluntary Life, where you can hear ideas for finding freedom in an unfree world. Visit thevoluntarylife.com to connect with the show and hear all past episodes. Here's your host, Jake.
Hi, patrons. It's Jake here. I recently appeared on a podcast in New Hampshire called The Freecast, and you can find that podcast at freecoast.org. And in this bonus episode, I'm playing you my segment on that podcast. I was interviewed on the podcast and I was asked about my childhood and how I came to develop some of the ideas that I have now. So I hope you enjoy this interview and I'll be back with more bonus episodes soon.
Okay, so next we want to talk a little bit more to Jake and kind of find out what he's up to. Mike, did you want to start us off maybe with a question or two?
Sure. So Jake, you know, you were our keynote on the cruise at Freecoast Fest this year. I found your talk very enlightening. Your theme was living a voluntary life today. And one of the aspects that really struck me was you talking about your childhood growing up and your family basically being communist and seeing the, why don't you tell us a little bit about what it's like to grow up in a communist household and how it's different to be in the liberty movement versus the communist movement?
Well, in terms of what it's like, I mean, my parents split up when I was quite young. So my mum lived in a squat in South London, mm-hmm. An occupied building. It was actually the whole street was essentially abandoned houses that had been occupied by squatters.
Okay. I was going to ask what squat meant, but you do really actually mean squatters, like people who don't own the property, aren't renting the property, but are just hanging out there.
Okay. Exactly.
It's the original Occupy movement.
Yeah. And she was involved in basically like really hard left wing politics. So I grew up around people who were interested in starting a communist revolution, and they meant it too. Mm. I mean, luckily for me, these were more the intellectual types, so they weren't doing anything violent. They were reading books and having like discussions about what Karl Marx wrote and stuff like that. And they were, I think, amongst those kinds of groups, they were definitely a clever bunch, and they weren't involved in sort of like, as I say,
violent actions
there, but not because they didn't think there was a role for violence, but they thought like, there's no point in doing that stuff now. We need to, you know, form a movement and get our ideas straight first. But they did actually believe that there is a role for violence. And so, you know, it was a very long process for me to think through what was wrong with that idea for myself and, you know, what was both morally wrong with it and practically wrong with ideas of communism and socialism. And in thinking that through, I thought through what was unreasonable about that particular political program. But once you start questioning political programs, you realize that they're all unreasonable.
The whole thing unravels.
Right. The whole thing unravels. And so
now, didn't you say though that you noticed that they had this vision of the end goal, the utopia, but that where everyone was going to be nice and peaceful, but in order to get there, you could be as ruthless as possible.
Yeah. I mean, that's the weird thing that is interesting about communists' relationships with their ideals, because they do have ideals and their ideals are very, very important to them. Mm. And the ideal is great. It's a peaceful world of prosperity where everyone cooperates.
Imagine
on big projects.
All the people. Yeah.
Right, yeah. Right. You know, and so The interesting thing is that they've managed to get themselves into this mindset where if you believe in that ideal, then you have to fight to achieve it. And it will only be achieved after the revolution. And the only way that the revolution will happen is if we're totally ruthless now. So what happens is that the more you think you believe in this wonderful ideal of peace and cooperation and people actually working together to create more prosperity and a better world, the more you believe in that, the more vicious you actually should be in this life, in the life before the revolution. And it's a really weird thing, because if you didn't know about those ideals and you just saw the kind of life that leads you to lead, then you would see that it really means that you have a very nihilistic and vicious approach to human relationships. And so if you watched people who are really dedicated to communism, if you watch their lives as a silent movie and you didn't know about the ideals that a lot of them really genuinely do hold about this beautiful world.
You would just see them as murdering.
Like right, you just see them as yeah. as really vicious people.
Yeah. Which is how we see them.
Right, but yeah.
And now you've gotten to experience the premier liberty community on the planet, if I say so myself. How do you think a voluntary leaning society differs?
Well, this is the thing that I was trying to talk about in my talk, that what's really important to me is I want to make sure that I don't have that disconnect between ideals that I hold and the way that I actually behave. And for me, the really wonderful thing about taking the ideas of liberty and applying them in your personal life and really using them as a guide to living your own life in your individual relationships, in the people you do business with and so forth, is that if you do that, there should be no difference between the ideals of voluntarism and your actual life in the way that you live it. And the great benefit of that is that it leads you to invest in your relationships, to create positive win-win situations with other people, to find ways to make the world better through non-coercive voluntary means. And so if you watch that kind of life as a silent movie, you'd see people, you know,
it looks like the ideal.
Right. Yeah. It looks like the ideal. Right. And in a way, you are actually living Libertopia in your own life. You know, you are a little bit of voluntary society in your own life.
What are your most important practices to that end? Like what types of things do you do on either a daily basis or in your life to express liberty, voluntarism?
Well, I think this comes back to what we were talking about with Catalonia. You know, what's really important for me is I have no interest in giving any legitimacy to politics whatsoever. I see my way of contributing to making the world better as being entirely in the realm of non-political action. And in particular, that means things like entrepreneurship, and it means things like finding ways to create more wealth in the world and create financial independence for myself and my family. And of course, there's lots of other ways that you know, you can apply these ideals. But that's the key thing, I think, is that I see it as a non-political life where you find positive ways to contribute to the world through things like entrepreneurship.
Right on.
Well, that's, I mean, there's sort of this, I don't really believe in superstition, but, you know, the closest thing to karma is it seems like the people who follow the political means end up kind of miserable unless they're real hard, like committed sadists. And the people who, I feel like we're often correct me if I'm wrong. We catch ourselves like looking at our own community and is like, is this real? It's like we created this little, like, you know, we all live on a cloud and we're, you know, trading rainbows and, you know, and it's like, when did this happen? But it's like, you know, a bunch of people who mean well, backed up by good ideas. I'm curious, Jake, what your experience is. You guys have traveled a lot. What is based on your travels, what does the liberty movement look like in different places? What does it look like in Spain? What does it look like in Panama? And what does it look like through your eyes coming here to the Free Coast?
Well, I genuinely think, and I'm not just saying this because, you know, I'm here, but I genuinely think that you do have something special going on here in terms of just having a great concentration of people who are interested in similar things like peaceful parenting, like unschooling, like entrepreneurship, and of course, fundamentally underneath all of that, like liberty. We've met wonderful people in Panama and around the world, but they're individuals that we've met. They're not all concentrated in one place. And that's what's really interesting about this part of New Hampshire and about New Hampshire in general is that, I mean, I think there's a lots of different things going on in New Hampshire in terms of people. Like I think we were talking about this before. Some people are interested in liberty more because they just really, they have a lot of anger towards the state and they want to express that anger. And that to me is not the same thing as being interested in constructive ways to have positive voluntary relationships.
Indeed, yeah.
And so, you know, I think there's different people who get attracted to coming to places like this for different reasons. But what's fascinating for me is to meet all of you guys and people in this community who are genuinely interested in the positive side, not just the, you know, complaining side about, oh, isn't it bad that there is a state and that there's all these things going on, but rather are more focused on, well, what can we do to live positive, constructive lives.
Mm. Nice.
Thank you for being a patron of The Voluntary Life. Your support makes The Voluntary Life podcast possible and is helping to grow and improve the show.